Hi, everybody. For those of you who are new to these masterclass series, my name is Chloe. I am on the video team here at Jazz at Lincoln Center. In just a minute, we're going to join Jazz at Lincoln Center Orchestra saxophonist and composer Ted Nash, along with Seton Hawkins from our education team, for part two of Ted's Wayne a Shorter celebration. Now that we've looked into Wayne's legendary contributions as a sideman in part one of this masterclass, Ted will now go over Wayne's work as a band leader and explore some of his most indelible contributions to the music. After the lesson, Ted will answer some questions from you all. At that time, I'll jump back in and explain how to ask a question. In the meantime, if you have anything you'd like to say, feel free to shoot me or the public a message in the chat, and we'll try and keep an eye on those as well. All right, enjoy. I'm going to turn it over to Ted and to Seton.
Thanks, well, Chloe.
Yeah.
What's up, Seton?
How you doing?
All right, man.
Now, for everyone who's just joining, what you missed earlier was a magical moment where Ted and I hopped on Zoom and realized we were wearing the exact same shirt. So I have since gone for a more patterned option, just so it didn't look like we coordinated. But I'm really excited about today. The tracks that Ted has sent over are an amazing glimpse into Wayne's career as a composer and as a improviser and a band leader within his own records. So maybe we just dive right in with the very first one. Does that work for you?
Yeah, his first record, yes.
Yeah. All right, so we're going to go back to 1959. So this is an album called Introducing Wayne Shorter. Now, we should be clear that Wayne Shorter had already thoroughly been introduced, but as a sideman. So when he makes this record, he's with an Art Blakey fellow member. Lee Morgan is playing trumpet. One of Wayne's previous employers, Wynton Kelly, is playing piano. Wayne had previously recorded with Wynton Kelly a couple of years prior. And then it's almost like a Miles Davis alumni love fest, because Wynton is playing piano, Paul Chambers is playing bass, Jimmy Cobb is the drummer. And this is recorded for VJ Records in Chicago, which is predominantly known as a more like an R&B record. But Ted, why don't you kick us off with why you picked the piece, which is Harry's Last Stand, and your thoughts on the track.
Well, it's so interesting because we talk a lot about Wayne's, we did last week, we talked a lot about his influence, like the influences that the what inspired him, Coltrane, how we could hear Dexter in his playing, and of course how very quickly he became such an iconic, unique player that was one who everybody else copied. But what I love about this track, Harry's Last Stand, is when you listen to it, and this is the first thing that I noticed about his solo, is that he develops this theme. He takes a little motif and starts to develop it. And I was thinking, you know, this reminds me so much of Sonny Rollins at the Vanguard, Sunny Moon for Two, because Sunny Moon for Two, Sonny just starts playing this one little motif and just works it for like five choruses, slowly adding little pieces. And I thought this was so interesting because this record was made maybe, what, 2 years after? It probably came out 2 years after Live at the Vanguard, Sonny Rollins. And then at the very end of his solo, Wayne quotes something, which I'll just let you all listen to that and you can pick up on that. But check out how he develops the very beginning of his solo. And then at some point, go back and visit that live at the Vanguard with Sonny Moon for Two. It's remarkable. I think it's such a fun discovery for me just to hear that, because I love Sonny at the height of his playing in the 50s. And of course, he was influencing everybody who was playing at that time. I mean, he had to have been.
Absolutely. Yeah. So let's dive in. So this is Harry's Last Stand. We're going to play a chunk of the head and a chunk of Wayne's solo. Obviously, for today, as if you were here last Monday, you'll know we're excerpting just in the interest of time. So here we go. Thank you.
Well, it's interesting because it must be on the it must be on a later part or on another track on that record where he quotes Sunny Moon for Two at the very end of it. I didn't hear it on that.
I think it's when he comes back in. Yeah,
he comes back in. And for me, man, I hear so much Sunny in his playing right there. And we've talked so much about the train thing, but like if you catch Sunny Moon for Two or any of, you know, what Sunny was doing, Sunny Rollins was doing at that time, but particularly that blues track. The way he uses the tritone substitutions, the way he leaves kind of space, but really predominantly is using linear kind of bebop lines all the way through there. And, you know, perhaps it's because it's so early for Wayne. It's 1959, it's his first record. And you can totally hear the kind of Blakey swing and that type of approach to writing and playing, which for me is, it's interesting because he's got Miles' rhythm section, but he's really still got that kind of Blakey thing happening. That's very cool.
Well, it is striking. I mean, one of the things we talked about last week is Wayne's movement into an almost impossible to define space as far as genres. But on this debut, he's really working hard in that kind of hard bop idiom. He's playing a really mean blues there too. Yeah. It is fascinating to hear him at that early stage.
Yeah, and the way he's creating the lines and accenting and playing, and it's very much in the more of the bebop, hard bop tradition than he deals with, even at that time, but particularly just a short time after that, where he becomes a lot more flowing and is taking more risks and kind of running lines and stuff. And here, everything is very time-based, very, very much in the time and in that tradition of creating tension and releasing the implications of the harmonies, particularly like the 5-1 kind of resolutions that he does. Yeah. Doing the four chord of the blues and all that. And he only does that little bit of kind of development of that motif just for that first chorus. But if you go back and check out Sonny, how he just takes that one motif and has so much fun with it. And I love that because it's the mark of maturity that you can just take one little idea and play with it forever, because it's like saying, you know, you have the rest of your life to do something else.
I like that.
You could just deal with that for now. I know all this other stuff, but I just want to deal with this right now. And as an immature player, we often just play everything we know as soon as we can because we want to let everybody know how much we know. And I think Wayne was one of these kind of people who didn't care so much about impressing anybody with what he knew, but he was trying to get to some truth. He was such an interesting cat too. Do you know that the writer, what's his name? I wrote it down. Amiri Baraka says that he knew Wayne in Newark when they were growing up. And he said there was an expression that came that they all said, it's called as weird as Wayne. Man, that's as weird as Wayne. Just like an expression they all used. I love that. But he was such a genius. He was such a deep thinker. He was into philosophy. They really were encouraging him to go into college and study philosophy. He loved Fountainhead, which was a novel by Ayn Rand that dealt with themes and that was very inspiring to me when I was a teenager. But there's one thing I wanted to just read. I think this is so beautiful. In an interview, he was asked, what can we do to save jazz? Which I love these kind of questions because, like, you know, every decade jazz is completely dying, right? We're always concerned that jazz is dying, and here we are. It's like decades later, people are still asking these questions. But he said, I think that taking chances is the beginning. Being unafraid of losing this and that, jobs, friends, you don't have to have the extreme you see in biographies of Van Gogh, always being by himself or arguing with others, but you've got to have a lot of leeway, knowing the difference between what you're told and what you find out for yourself. Starting as an individual, being alone, you don't have to preserve jazz. We don't have to preserve jazz. We just have to start preserving the stuff that comes before all that. And, you know, just, he's never going to answer a question in a kind of a pat way. He's always going to be thinking deeply about stuff. Very inspiring. His, just who he is inspiring. And that's why his music is so great.
Now, this actually segues really beautifully into the next track you picked. So you picked Speak No Evil, the title track. And there's a couple things that I think are really fascinating about the selection of this. One is that particular album, Wayne talks about being inspired by and trying to draw from extra musical influences. So with Speak No Evil, he's looking at some of the things that would inspire folkloric tales around the world. So he talks about the idea and the imagery of misty mountains and things like that. And what's also striking about this album is it comes out in 1966, but it's in the middle of this spate of insanely productive work in 1964 when he does Night Dreamer, Juju, and Speak No Evil in the span of about 8 months.
Yeah, like this one was December, but it's still 1964. It's crazy that he did three incredible albums in that short amount of time.
Yeah, and I think that speaks to what you were saying. This is an artist who stretched out enormously and sort of tried to bring in all sorts of influences throughout the world.
Mm-hmm. Totally, yeah. And this, so this is the third one he did, and it's also what, let's see. I know this is the same year that he was asked to join Miles's band too, right?
Yeah.
For us, I think is when he got the call and joined the band. But I saw Ethan Iverson, a great pianist, and he has a blog, and I saw him talking about Wayne at one point. He talked about Night Dreamer. He said that, and Juju, he was talking about these records, but on Juju, he said 12 more bars to go, one of the greatest recorded tenor saxophone solos in the blues idiom. So I think that's kind of an interesting thing to check out. I mean, he was so deeply rooted in blues, as were so many of the players who came up in the 50s. And the other thing about this record is that it probably has the biggest collection of the most learned songs by students and professional musicians by a single artist. I mean, everybody knows all of these songs. You go to jam sessions, you're walking down the hallway in colleges, between practice rooms, and you hear all these tunes. And there's something about his approach to writing. We talked a little bit last week about how his writing went from being kind of cadence oriented, like 2-5-1, like we talk about this style of composing that most of the music during the Blakey era, even with Benny Golson's music, that was so creative in how he would figure out how to get from one place to another. On this, and on this track, Speak No Evil especially, you hear the movement, the almost arbitrary movement of chords, rather than cadence oriented, it jumps like this, but it makes complete sense. It's not arbitrary in the sense that it doesn't make any sense. It still gets you from point A to point B in a way that feels natural, but it doesn't do that through like cliche ways. And that's the thing about Wayne, is he was never cliche.
He
quickly moved away from cliches. That's what's amazing at a very young age.
So let's play this. So this is, again, the title track. This is Speak No Evil. It's recorded December of 1964. He has one of his fellow compatriots from Blakey era, Freddie Hubbard, is playing trumpet. Coltrane's drummer, Elvin Jones, is playing on this. And then the two other members of the Miles Davis Quintet, Herbie Hancock and Ron Carter, are playing on this. It's a really, really iconic band. So let's check it out. Feel pain that we had to pause there.
I know it's such a shame, right?
Oh my God.
Incredible. I mean, just for the first, I know you probably have a lot of things to say about the scene, but the first thing that I notice is just the way that they deal with the head, the melody and everything, the sense of dynamics and the way that it's the range with a little bit of a interlude and then back. It almost has a sense of a big band within a very small group, which, you know, maybe Blakey and with Benny Golson's music and some of the stuff that they were dealing started to have that sense of arrangement. But this almost feels like a big band to me. The way it builds up, you know, it's like got that kind of excitement. That's something remarkable, I think.
Absolutely. Well, the other thing I find very striking is even though he has just barely joined the Miles Davis Quintet at that point, so many of the ideas you'll hear them exploring in like ESP, you hear him laying that groundwork right now, and you hear Herbie and you hear Ron stretching out as well. I just find that so staggering.
And we were talking before about one of the key components to the way he sets up his solos is using space so well.
Yeah.
And I think that he does that in his solos, of course, and you can hear it so much in this solo, but also in just this tune. I mean, there's the way he did it, but then he allows all the space for Herbie to fill. That's pretty unusual at this time to have that kind of space within the melody. It's a very simple melody, but it's because of that, it makes it more complex, just in the sense of allowing a lot of improvisation within. And also the solos are longer now. Like in the first record, you can hear how they're concerned about keeping the solo short. Like if you go back to Bird and everything, they play very short solos. And now we're starting to get stretched out solos. And so it becomes less about the songs and more about the interplay and the interaction and the trust between the musicians and the band. You can hear the kind of communication that he has with Herbie at different times there. And I think that's very, very strong. And you do hear some of his trained influence, but you also start to hear that chromaticism that he starts do, 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 do. He starts to put in there, which becomes a real Wayneism, you know? It's like something that a lot of people picked up on when they started to copy him. That sort of use of chromatic movement downward, which is such a unique sound.
It's funny, as I was listening, one of the things that I thought was I so desperately wish we could get a time machine and get Coltrane to record this as well, because to get a side by side of how those two artists would have interpreted that particular space would be just for another life, I guess.
Yeah, I know, and it's interesting because Train was really, well, at this point, he was finding a lot of spirituality, and his music was moving a lot in direction away from this kind of kind of just song-oriented stuff and swing and all that. But prior to this and around this time, he was still playing with a lot of sheets kind of stuff and filling a lot and playing and not leaving a lot of space. So it's interesting how Wayne could have easily been like, well, I can do that. I can play just as much as Train. I can get all in there. And he starts to find all that space in his playing. I just love that. It's so inspiring.
In fact, our reference point, this is recorded December of 1964 December, that's Train recording A Love Supreme. So that's, you know, our benchmark, I suppose.
Right.
Now, with that in mind, this again is recorded December 1964. We now fast forward for our next track 7 years into the future. So by this point, the Miles Davis Second Great Quintet has come and gone. The Lost Quintet of Miles Davis has come and gone. In a Silent Way has happened. Bitches Brew has happened. Woodstock has happened. We're now in 1971.
Right.
And we have
Weather. Good point. That's good. I haven't thought about that. Right. That's right. This is post Woodstock. That's a big
deal. Yeah. So moving forward to this ensemble, which is now a co-led affair of Wayne and Joe Zawinul, what are some of your earliest impressions when you were listening to Weather Report?
Well, it's funny because when Weather Report started, I mean, they, for about 15 years were a band. And so I didn't start playing until maybe 5 years, 4 years into their band being established. So by the time I started playing, I was just getting started with Bird and Sonny and Coleman Hawkins and stuff. And so when I heard this music, for me, it was too rock oriented and too kind of spacey or electric or something. I didn't relate to it when I was young. So for me, I didn't really pick up on this and kind of appreciate it until later. But I do know that fusion music was huge. I mean, Bitches Brew, for as much as some people really didn't like that and kind of resisted it. And Mel Lewis, who I used to work with, the drummer, said that Miles came into the club and he started yelling at Miles about this rock music that he's doing and everything. And even Wynton, who says to Miles at one point, kind of challenging him, goes, Miles, man, how does it feel to have been playing all this great, great music and then be BSing so much later in your life? And then Miles says, you'll find out. Which, you know, is great because Miles doesn't really, I mean, he believed in everything he did. He wasn't BSing. I mean, he felt this music, he heard it. So for me, I mean, just to say that my first reaction was I wasn't that crazy about it, but the musicians are so amazing and their concept is so clear. I mean, one thing is Wayne is only playing soprano on this record, which I think at this point, I don't know how many people were really playing the soprano that much. Yeah. I mean, there were a few people, but he became like the soprano.
Yeah. Okay.
So he plays it on that. I know that we've talked last week about his fascination with the cinema and with theater, and I think he's just got the most incredible imagination. And for this band to be able to do what they did, I mean, you have to have people with incredible imaginations.
Yeah.
So I really appreciate that, and it sounds great to me now, of course, you know. But I know that for this, they got the Jazz Album of the Year in Downbeat, Reader's Poll. Mm-hmm. So people did like this music a lot. They were very attracted to it.
Yeah.
Chick Corea's Light as a Feather came out the following year, which was another kind of fusion band. And so it was just part of what was happening. And it wasn't like a sellout. This was what people were hearing. This was important music.
Oh, yeah. What I find really striking with Weather Report, I mean, for people who really know them from later albums or say the Heavy Weather album, the early Weather Report albums are a trip in those moments. They really show the influence of In a Silent Way, of Bitches Brew, that much more abstract, experimental space.
Right.
And I think the album you picked, the debut of 71, is such a great example of it.
Yeah.
So you picked Seventh Arrow. So should we dive in and check it out?
Yeah, and maybe just, you know, for a little bit of it. What I love about this is you'll check it out. Let's just put it on. I know this is not Wayne's original, right?
Right. The bassist, Miroslav Vitu, wrote this.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we're hearing a very abstract space there.
Well, it's interesting because the contrasts, and I think that Wayne was a master of contrast, and this is an example of a device I think that is really, really wonderful, which is creating a lot of intensity and movement in the rhythm section, a lot of movement and activity. So as a soloist, you could just jump in there and play a bunch of activity too, but it's so effective that he's playing simple lines on top of that and leaving the space. Again, dealing with the space. And that allows the rhythm section to continue and fill up and not feel like you're competing with that. You're allowing it to happen and making your comments on top of it. It's again, another sense of real maturity. And for me, like, just even though it's completely different, you see the through line from Speak No Evil to this, because it's vamp oriented.
Mm-hmm.
You create a little something and you allow the piano to sort of fill, and then you create a little bit more response to that. So I think in a way, Speak No Evil was much more organized in the sense that the piano fill is going to be for, you know, 4 bars, 3 bars or whatever, and then the melody. And then like, this is sort of like just that idea of some comments, some fills, that kind of allowing, again, trust to take over and let things develop, and trusting that it's going to go somewhere without you having to control it as much by writing it all out. And this is largely improvised. You could hear that little thing in the beginning. It kind of sets up the vibe.
Mm-hmm.
And boom. Who needs to write everything out when you've got these incredible musicians who can improvise as if they're composing at this on the spot? And that's one thing that Wayne Shorter was a genius at, was improvising in a sense that was like composing.
Absolutely. Well, to that effect, there's an artist on this track who I think is almost a preview of the next one to come. We have Ayrton Moreira as the percussionist on that, and he's giving us that incredible dance-like sort of pulse underneath the band. And to that effect, the next track you picked is from a 1975 album. So in the midst of Weather Report, Wayne Shorter releases an album where he's nodding to and embracing Brazilian musical styles called Native Dancer, pulling in particular Milton Nascimento. And the track that you've picked, A, is one of the best tracks ever. So I'm glad we're going to check that out. But also, you arranged this for the JLCO in a 2015 performance. So what I'm hoping we can do is start with Wayne's track, talk about it a bit, and then move to how you interpreted it in an arrangement.
I mean, that'd be great. We could just play a little bit of the arrangement because it's obviously pretty long.
Right.
And just to some history on this, is this did come out around the time that I was first playing, and I got this record, and it was challenging for me because it wasn't ding, 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 bebop that I was into, but it spoke to me also because of the clarity of it. His absolute commitment to melody and expression is so strong on this record. And it is a bit commercial in a sense, but it's so musical. He said, the one essence I try to bring out in the composition would be the essence of courage, the never give up spirit. I want the sound of noble causes to penetrate the music, and the frivolity, help me with the pronunciation of that, of delusions and illusions. I want the music to be graphic so that people will see the pictures and be moved by the motion picture aspect of my compositions and see themselves in this soundtrack of life. I think these songs have that kind of imagery, that kind of imagination for me.
Yeah.
This one in particular, Gianna, actually.
Gianna, yeah. All right, so let's check this out, and then let's chat a little bit more about it, and then let's check out your arrangement, because it is a really interesting approach you've taken.
Thank you.
You know, I will never get tired of hearing that piece. That is so gorgeous.
It's so haunting.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, his use of the themes. The thing is, it's complex, but it sounds simple. I can't tell if it's so simple and it sounds complex, or if it's so complex and it sounds simple, but there's something about that.
There's a couple things in the melody and the harmony I'm curious about. The beginning almost is like Eric Satie-esque, and the harmonies are extremely kind of impressionistic. I'm curious about your thoughts on the composition.
Well, I love, because there's this chord that I love so much, and it's like a minor 11 or 13 or something. That's when you just kind of go all the way up and you extend it so far up that it becomes almost like a suspense chord or like a suspended chord, but it's like a chord that has all possibilities in it, because it just opens up and it feels very optimistic and it feels very evocative at the same time. And I think when you, especially he moves stuff around parallel a little bit, and you've got these open 13 minor chords that move around, and it's very evocative for me. And as far as the composition goes, you can't really say, oh, he's doing this, he's doing that. He's hearing something.
Yeah.
And he's figuring out how to express the thing that he's feeling and hearing. And that's what's so beautiful about this. It's not like, oh yeah, these are the chords. The chords are just something that he could find so he could say, this is what I'm feeling. It's remarkable.
So with that in mind, we fast forward to 2015, and I'm just going to randomly put this in the camera's view. This came out quite recently, actually. Came out earlier this year. This is the Jazz Lincoln Center Orchestra's recording of the music of Wayne Shorter with a special guest by the name of Wayne Shorter. So that was a concert from 2015, and you arranged Gianna for the performance. So I'm curious about how you approached such a very minimalist piece for the big band recording, and your approach, knowing that Wayne was going to be there, hearing it, performing on it.
I'm getting nervous now just hearing you say that. when you have one of your heroes and you're conducting and they're looking at you for cues, it's I can't even explain. I do know that when I started to work on this arrangement, I tried, first of all, I looked for someone who had transcribed it just to see what someone was dealing with. And I couldn't find any good representation of this. So I ended up having to do a lot of the kind of transcribing of what, and it's a little complex because you don't know some of what he's doing and why he's doing it. But the most important thing about trying to do this arrangement is not just to try to say, okay, I'm going to put my stamp on it, or I'm going to come up with all this hip stuff to put on top of it. It's to try to be inside of his head and say, what is he feeling and thinking? Because I don't want this arrangement to take away from what he was trying to do. I just try to say, well, we have 15 musicians plus him. How can we just make an extension of what he already conceived? I mean, this is basically a duet. You just hear some cymbals, a little bit of synth kind of stuff coming in and out. But essentially, it's just a duet. And so how do you capture that feeling with the band? I don't quite, because I have a whole band playing it, but I still try to respect what I think he was trying to do. And I have no idea. I never really spoke to him directly about what he thought about it. I'd love to hear what he thought about it. But that was one of the highlights of my life, was to look over him and hear him playing this and its arrangement that I did. So. Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, let's check it out. We'll listen to a few minutes of it, and it's such a gorgeous arrangement. So I'm hoping everyone gets a chance to check it out in full, and indeed check out the entire album. I am paid to say that, but it is still a true statement.
Thank you.
Pausing here, but in my defense, there was no good place to stop that track. That track needed to be played in full. But yeah, any further thoughts on that approach of the arranging?
Well, just, I don't know, just at first, like, I get emotional hearing him because he's like, he's still dealing with whatever that is, that thing that he has, you know, just being able to just play. It's crazy. No, I would just say that, you know, I really didn't want to get in his way. And listening to it now, I start to say, wow, you know, I have those instruments up in there. Maybe they could have backed off. You know, I didn't get involved with the balancing of it. But he still has that ability to just say something in such a unique way that's so extremely personal that I'm happy that we could frame that for him. And again, finding all those extended minor chords are so beautiful. And it was an honor, such an honor to be able to do that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So you made an interesting point that, you know, the original recording sounds a bit like a duet. As we fast forward to the last track you picked, there is a moment where Gianna is played as a duet when Wayne and Herbie reunite on the 1+1 album in 97.
Right.
Like that song was the template for that entire duet album.
Right.
A couple of years after that, he will form the Wayne Shorter Quartet of him, Danilo Perez, John Patitucci, and Brian Blade. And that has been his band now for two decades. You pulled a track from one of the early recordings they make, the Live Footprints album from 2002. Can you talk a bit about that particular piece and that quartet?
Well, I think that first of all, this happened to so many artists who kind of had, like, went over here for a while and over there for a while. A lot of times you just come back to something that feels like home. And I feel this quartet for him was that, in that they're still dealing with a lot of the language of swinging and a kind of contemporary straight ahead jazz, mainstream sort of way of approaching music rather than synthesizers and big themes and sounds and all of that. So it's like coming back to something. And when this record came out, I ran out and bought it. I just sat there and I loved how much interplay. The thing about, Brian and Dino and John is that they've had their own time to be able to understand what it is Wayne is about. You know, Wayne was lucky to get these musicians who understood him, said, we know how to give him the space to be him.
Yeah.
And again, you see a lot of the space and the interplay that was starting to happen early in his career. I know that I think it started to be called the Footprints Band, like the First Footprints Band or something. But the fact that he stayed with this one band for such a long time is really, really speaks to the musicianship and how they created a space for him to be himself. I know that Tavis Smiley asked him, said, how much does his quartet rehearse? And he says, how do you rehearse the future? I love that.
Yeah, this.
You know, how do you? You don't plan. You can't. You just have to say, okay, I trust this. Love it.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, let's check this out. So this is Footprints. Yeah. I mean, this is a warhorse of Wayne Shorterdom, and I agree. The reinterpretation here is stunning. So
yeah.
Let's dive right in. Ooh. Thank you. Just in the interest of time, I'm going to pause here, but
yeah,
one thing that you mentioned, this idea of the more open space, I don't want to say free jazz, but there is something that's so open in the structure. And can you talk a bit more about what it is you're hearing this quartet doing?
Well, yeah, I think it is almost like free jazz in a sense that, I guess saying free jazz means basically you don't have a set form or a set time or a set harmonic structure, whatever. but just freedom. Freedom is what free jazz, for me, speaks to. It's like just the idea of being free. And they don't have the kind of restraints that players did so many decades before. And you can hear the through line definitely from the Miles kind of Herbie, Ron, Tony thing, but with a little bit more modern language. So they've all checked all that music out because it's like the iconic, you know, history of our music. So for me, Wayne is at the height of his freedom, and they know how to respond to that. So it's like saying, well, you don't have to keep track all the time. You don't have to be so worried about keeping track of every moment. You can just allow it to be. The form is there, it will be taken care of. You just open up and you play, you respond, you listen. You don't have any kind of preconceived ideas of what is going to happen. And that's freedom. So yeah. It's not holding on to something. I know that feeling of like wanting to hold on to something, to keep yourself on something. If you can let that go and then experience it in a different way, like how we can experience life without having everything being so organized and regimented, but just try to open up to something. And that's what I hear here. It's just that they, you can hear how they're doing little, little, little. They're kind of overlapping each other with all these fast runs and stuff. And it's not like about mimicking each other. It's about letting this conversation happen. And then Wayne stops, Danilo stops, and then Wayne starts playing something a little bit more rhythmic, and Danilo gets into the piano, starts accompanying him. And I love that trust that Wayne has with this group. And the freedom is quite apparent.
Yeah. But this seems to kind of come back to a theme that's recurred throughout the discussion today and last week, this idea of finding that particular freedom and that willingness to take those risks, those leaps. Given that we're in the final minutes before Q&A, is there any summation you want to make about what we can be drawing from listening to Wayne and studying his life and his music?
Well, I just like what Duke said so many years ago, be a number one yourself and not a number two somebody else. And Wayne was a number one of himself. I mean, he was truly in the moment and engaged. And when you find somebody like that you listen to and you're constantly inspired by and moved by, you know that it's not just they worked on their 2-5-1s and their scales and their stuff. They were looking at a much broader picture of what life is and who they are, and can bring that to the music. And that's what it is. It's like music is the opportunity to let people know what you're thinking and feeling and who you are. And Wayne isn't afraid to do that. I think some people are afraid to do that and hide behind the language, hide behind their technique, and hide behind all of that. And I don't think Wayne does that. And I mean, there are a lot of musicians who can do that as well, but he's probably the greatest example of that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So I know it's about 10 to 5, so I want to make sure we have time for questions. But firstly, I want, for everyone who's been tuning in, thank you. Thank you for joining us. And a big thank you to Ted, to dive in 2 weeks in a row and tackle one of the most iconic composers, players, improvisers of all time is daunting, because for every track that you pick, there's about 20 that you've had to leave off just in the interest of time. So with that, what I thought we can do is hand it back over to Chloe and open it up for questions for Ted.
Great.
Awesome, that sounds good to me. Thanks, guys. For anyone that's joining us late, this has been a masterclass with Ted Nash and Seton Hawkins, brought to you by Jazz at Lincoln Center. In just a minute, or I guess now, we'll open it up to questions. Before we get started, though, I just want to take a moment to thank everybody, all of our supporters, everyone that's here. You continue to help us serve the global jazz community. We really wouldn't be here without you. Your support means so much to us. So if there's a question you'd like to ask, please try to use the raise hand feature in Zoom. Click the participants tab on the bottom of your Zoom window and then press the raise hand button. You can also use the chat feature either on Facebook or here on Zoom. I'll keep an eye on that and I'll ask Seton maybe to keep an eye on it as well. Please make sure your name, your full name appears as your username so that I can call on you. Just click on your name. There's a little rename button there. Just makes it easier. I'll unmute you when it's your turn and we'll go from there. So if anyone has a question, please don't be shy. Go ahead and raise your hand or shoot us a question in the chat. All right, perfect. Our first question comes from Joshua Lamb. Oh, trying to unmute you, buddy. One sec. There you are. Hey, Joshua.
Hello, can you hear me? Hello?
Yeah, yes.
Okay, so I'm quite nervous right now. So I just want to say a heartfelt thank you for it. I just want to start by saying a heartfelt thank you to Jazz at Lincoln Center for the work you've done for the community. So I'm from Hong Kong, so this is like 5 in the morning, and I just want to tune in to listen to you talk. Yeah, so my question for Ted is, because I'm an arranger myself, and I've been hearing some of your arrangements as well, so I'm starting to explore a bit more about textures in the big band arrangement. So where do you think I should start? Because I think if I just the normal sound of a swing band is really fascinating to me, but then I do want to elevate the level to include something more interesting by exploring some textures. So I want to see how you think about it.
Well, it's interesting that you use the word interesting. I studied with Bob Brookmeyer for a little while when he ran the Jazz Composers Workshop. This was like 30 years ago. It still exists now in New York, but someone said, he asked somebody why they put something in there. And they said, I was trying to create interest. I wanted to make it more interesting. He said, that's the last reason you should do anything, is to make it more interesting. In other words, wow. it should be interesting because of the things that you thought of and felt and put into the arrangement, not that you're doing that. But that's an interesting thing to hear. I'll say the word interesting about 20 times. Basically, you develop all your tools. You need to know the history of arranging for big bands. I imagine you have a good idea of a lot of that from all your listening and probably the work you've already done, is to understand, of course, the history, the role of all the instruments, what they can do, what they have done, and then start to pay attention to what it is you are hearing, like what's coming out of you. And I use this example more and more. At first I didn't think much about it, but I did a couple projects with the actress Glenn Close, whose work as an actress is phenomenal and so moving. And I asked her, I think it might have been after she did The Wife, this recent movie, and I said, what is your process? I'm just so curious about how you prepare for your roles and what do you do? What's your technique? She goes, I don't really have much of a technique. I just use my imagination. And I was like, okay, cool. Sounds like some, you know, yeah, okay. Mm. And then more and more I thought about that. Imagination is everything. It really is. So Joshua, if you can imagine the band sounding a certain way and having the kind of textures that you're hearing, you'll figure it out. Mm. Figure out how you can get that sound that you're imagining. And you can get instruments. I've taken the saxophones and had them for like 3 minutes just play overtones, something like to create squeaks and overtones, or you can find other uses for the instruments than their normal use. Like you can get inside the piano and do all sorts of prepared stuff. I'm sure you know about that, but just there's a lot more ways that you can use harmonics on the bass, drum sounds, you know, percussion sounds from the drums, from the actual drum set, if you don't have percussion. And then mutes, trumpets can do all sorts of crazy things. I did a piece that had animal sounds in it, and we were able to get animal sounds out of the instruments. Wynton wrote a piece called The Jungle, and I had to be a siren, a police siren. So really pretty much anything you want, you can figure out how to get. So that's what I would say, is that don't worry about so much what techniques can I find I mean, how do I use the techniques that I know as much as how do I address my own imagination and then find a way to express that? Don't limit yourself. I mean, a lot of us still work within a certain kind of format that is fairly traditional with five saxophones, three or four trombones, four trumpets, et cetera, and stay within a certain kind of sound that we're all familiar with, but you're not limited. You're only limited by yourself. So just go for it. Just go for it. It's an exciting time.
Can I have a follow-up question? Yeah. How do you use your imagination when you don't have when you don't have a band right in front of you? I mean, it's really hard to think about the sound you want when it's just a piano and what you've been hearing.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Don't limit yourself. I mean, I sit at home and I write and I play piano, but I do a lot of my writing on the piano. I do a lot of my writings with my back on laying completely flat on the couch and my eyes closed. That's the way that I find a lot of ideas, just to close and imagine it. So don't be limited by your piano. Maybe you're not going to have the band play it right away, but you can still imagine them playing these ideas that you have. So you might use the piano to check maybe certain voicings and registers. The overtone series in the piano is a pretty good example of what the overtones will be like in trombones or saxophones or trumpets. So you can kind of trust if things sound muddy or too spread out or things like that. But imagine what the big band will sound like when you put it together. Just go ahead and write the music. Don't worry about getting it played right now. This is not a time to get stuff played anyway, unless you can send it out and do the remote thing, which a lot of people are doing. So you might even explore that. This is going to be a new way that a lot of music is going to be recorded, is to have people submit stuff and record it individually. So maybe take advantage of this time and see if you can get some players to record your parts. Maybe you could even ask them to try some different things. Hey, I'm trying to get this sound. How can we do that? Wynton does that. He'll pull us in the dressing room and say, hey man, I'm trying to get this sound. I'm thinking about these two piccolos or maybe this or that. And we'll try a couple of things, and it'll be like, cool, man, thank you. So it's always investigating.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah, I look forward to hearing your music.
Thanks, Joshua. Thanks for getting up early for us.
Or staying
all up right.
late.
Or staying up late, whichever one it was. We have a question from Facebook. This is from Pat Donaher. Pat wants to know, as a player and a writer, how do you play the harmonies of these tunes when so many lead sheets of them may not represent what Wayne and the band members were actually doing? What do you recommend for young players learning these tunes?
It's hard, I think, because I grew up in the era of the real book, and that was pretty much it. And it was like the real bad book, because the chords were often wrong, and even some of the melodies were wrong. I did an arrangement of Dolphin Dance, and I went to the real book just as a default. Man, that was so wrong. So first of all, we find these lead sheets and stuff, but they have nothing to do with what the original musicians probably wrote out and handed out to the band. So the musicians should transcribe all of the pieces they play. Don't just accept someone handing it to you, or especially coming from some kind of a fake book. Don't trust that. Take it. It's actually good to take the thing out of the real book or whatever, and then listen to it and make the changes right on it. Say, no, that's not a minor chord, that's a dominant chord. Or that melody was a half step, not a whole step. And because they make so many mistakes, but this is great training for the students. And Pat, man, I know you, and I know you're so dedicated and you care so much about your students. I really appreciate that. It's so important that the young musician uses their ear to do all this work. This is how you train your ear, by transcribing. So not only solos, but songs. And transcribe how, like take Dolphin Dance, transcribe it. Transcribe some of the solo work that people do on it. I took Herbie Hancock's intro chorus on Ciora, Lee Morgan's Ciora, and transcribed it. It took me forever, because I wasn't used to doing it, transcribing piano stuff. And his left hand and everything, it took me forever. But I learned so much about harmony he could make a five note chord sound so complex and deep because of the way he voiced it. And I that helped me a lot with also my big band writing. But that's the key. You have to get them to transcribe and learn the songs that way, not, and just from listening to the records, not from playing them necessarily with other students using a real book. That's not kind of how you learn a tune. That's how you learn how to play on them, but you don't learn the tunes that way.
Awesome. Thanks for your question, Pat.
Yeah, Pat.
All right, let's take a question from someone who's returning from last week, Mr. Leo Steinrad. Hey, Leo.
Leo, what's up?
Oh, there you go.
Hello again. So thank you for an excellent class last week and this week. It was really great. So I just wanted to say how a few years ago I heard that recording of Footprints and I was totally not ready for it. And it really was kind of really confused me. And so in regards to that kind of more improvised feel and counterpoint in between the piano and what Wayne Shorter was doing, are there any kind of examples of records that you know of where that kind of interplay is done on, that improvised interplay is done on like a larger scale? Similar, like I know of Ascension, but something in more in kind of the mainstream or straight ahead feel where that can kind of work.
Yeah, I mean, I always go back to Ornette Coleman's music, even later, because some of his recordings would just be like almost no really set forms, just improvisation. But there's so many players out there that have dealt with form and try to find the freedom within that. I mean, I used to play a lot with Frank Kimbrough and Ben Allison and stuff. We would just start playing. And this is such a great exercise to do, is to get a bunch of musicians that you like and just say, we're gonna play. And we're gonna play as if we're playing written music or as if we're playing a song, but we're just gonna listen to each other and completely shape and form the improvisation so it has the kind of arc to it. I think that's the problem, is that when you hear some musicians, like I've heard, like I used to go downtown and go to these knitting factory kind of gigs and stuff, which was like considered the downtown music scene, very, very avant-garde. And sometimes they would just start playing and the tenor player would just be for like 20 minutes, 30 minutes, but there would be never any kind of shape or arc to it. So there's so many, I mean, Arthur Blythe comes to mind, some of the music in the 70s that was like, not a reaction necessarily to the fusion music, but sort of almost like a way to say, well, we're not going to go that direction. We're going to go this direction. So they went just absolutely free. And you could check out, I mean, just I'll try to, maybe I'll come up with, I know we're going to have a lesson on your composition and stuff like that. So I'll come up with a little list of stuff that I've checked out that maybe you would want to listen to see.
Yeah, that'd be excellent.
There's so much music, and I can't think offhand of so many recordings that are exactly what you're asking. But I remember learning so much about the responsibility of playing and improvising when you have very little to guide you. Suddenly now everybody has a strong responsibility to shape the music and listen to each other, not just play on top of each other. I mean, New Orleans music is like that. Everyone's kind of improvising at the same time with strong forms, certainly, but there was a strong responsibility that came out of that. And you can go back as far as that, you know, to 100 years ago and check out the early jazz and how they were dealing with that. They were dealing with improvisation and playing at the same time and how they had to have the responsibility of, and it's the same. It's just a different kind of language, but it's the same thing, really.
Mm.
Yeah.
So very, very interesting. Thank you so much for another great class.
Oh yeah, Leo, thanks for being here.
Thank you, Leo. All right.
Real quick, Ted, to Leo's question, I would mention the Sun Ra Orchestra probably fits the bill.
Great. And,
great. The Brotherhood of Breath probably does too.
Sun Ra is great, yeah. That's a great example. There was an orchestra also called the Urban Primates. It was a big band that used to just play improvised music. They would never talk about the music. They would never look at anything. They would just start. And Frank Kimbrough was in that band. And he talked about the extreme sense of responsibility everyone had, because you have 15 people on the bandstand and it's improvised and it had to tell a story. It's interesting. But Sun Ra is a great example. Scene.
Yeah. Cool, guys. So we're at 10 after 5 already. So we can take one more question. But before we do, I just want to let you guys know that we'll be hosting free live events every day throughout the coming weeks, including more masterclasses, more conversations with members of the JLCO, question and answer sessions with Wynton. Tonight is Monday. Monday night's event, Skane's Domain. That's when Wynton takes questions from you guys. Please feel free to join us on Zoom or on Facebook. It's always a good time. Our next JLCO masterclass will be Wednesday. That will be with bassist Carlos Enriquez, and he'll be demonstrating how to get a clear and rich sound out of the bass. We'll be broadcasting live on Wednesday, May 20th at this same time right here on Zoom and on Facebook. And please feel free to check out Jazz Lincoln Center's online hub, jazz.org, for a full calendar. Thanks again to everyone for being part of the community. If it's within your means, we have to say it, right? Please consider making a donation. We are a nonprofit organization, and this pandemic has affected us as well as so many other arts organizations around the country and around the world. So your help is and your contributions are so grateful, so appreciated. Okay, great. So we have a question in the chat about your five essential Wayne Shorter records, Ted. But I think what we'll do is take this question from Domani. And then at the end, maybe you can just type in some of your essential albums into the chat, and then we'll end it there. How does that sound?
Sounds good. Although we've chosen, I think, 10 records over 2 years, that I kind of think are the essential ones, and maybe we can type that in.
Yeah. Well, it's also worth mentioning at the beginning of this, Seton put in a Spotify link to the music we just played. So I'll just reshare that for anyone that joined us late, and then it's on the Facebook as well.
Good, because at the kind of today and last week, the 10 that I've chosen that we listened to that Seton played for us kind of represent my feeling about that.
Okay, good to know. It's cool. So we'll just go to this question from Domani. Hey, Domani, how are you?
Hi, Mr. Hawkins, Mr. Nash. Thank you for doing this so much. Kind of building off of what you talked about in the last question, you talked about improv at the end, and I'm sort of new to jazz. I've been playing saxophone for a little bit now, and my question is kind of more on the simple end, but just talking about improvisation, building your own ideas, what's your overall tips for that? I've been working on things, you know, like scale patterns, some blues licks, chord progressions. What's your advice on someone starting up on improv and how to start building more complex ideas as you advance in your career?
Well, first of all, it's great. No, you sound like you're doing everything right. Listening to as much music as possible is probably key, so that you have as much influence as possible. We've talked about this a little bit last week, is that we all start out emulating and copying other people, and maybe we sound like them for a while. We don't have to worry so much about that, because our natural style and ability will come out of that. So don't be too concerned. Just do the work, because you will get better. That's the thing. It's like, all you have to do is work hard and you will get better. If you find that there are areas of your playing that are not as strong as others, then you can pay attention to that. I always like to break it down into 4 kind of distinct areas of how we work on our improvisation. One is technical ability. So working on scales, patterns, challenging yourself to play things that you're not used to playing, so that your fingers develop flexibility. And of course, all sorts of scales and different things at different speeds, and playing written music. So that gets your technical ability together. Then you've got harmonic understanding and theoretical knowledge, which is the harmony. For me, it's like kind of the meat of everything. I love the depth of of harmony, the implications of certain cadences and all that. And there are books that are written about it. You hear it, you transcribe it, you start to absorb it and understand it, you analyze. This is work that you have to do as well. And then there's just expression, which is not just playing everything, but you know, being able to use different, could it be technical things, how you bend a note, how you might growl, how you might have dynamics in your playing, and all of that, the color, and help to make it more expressive. Or it's the way that you can use your expression, and these are the physical things that you choose to represent the things that you're feeling and hearing. And then idea development is just that when we're playing and improvising, we're not just playing a bunch of notes. We're taking all of this stuff that we've already worked on, and now we're just making ideas. So you can develop your instinct in this area by, when you practice, take a little theme. We talked about that earlier, how Wayne and Sonny Rollins, particularly on Sunny Moon for Two, took a little theme and kept developing it. And so that's idea development. And what that does is it engages the people who are listening and the other musicians that are playing. So idea development, like All right, so it's like I took a little theme and I kind of developed it through an idea. So we practice those, set out like actual routines to say, I'm gonna, for this next two or three choruses, I'm just gonna take this one theme and I'd see how many different ways I can develop it. And in the center of all that is rhythm. I mean, you've got rhythm that deals with all four of those things. But just pay attention to those, the four corners of improvisation, because they all have to kind of work together. So if you feel like you don't have enough technique, but you have all these ideas, well, then you're not gonna get your ideas out. If you have a ton of technique and nothing, no feeling at all, then who cares, right? So, but transcribe, listen to as much as possible, copy, and then just keep working on it. And you can't help but to get better. So it'll be cool.
Awesome, thank you so much.
Yeah, man, yeah, Damani. Well, thank you, everybody. I really appreciate everybody getting on here and listening. And just to back up what Chloe said, anybody who's in the position to help out, even a $5 donation is extremely, extremely appreciated. Wynton talks about that. Man, I got a $10 donation, man. We appreciate every little thing. It just helps to keep connected to people. And they're constantly putting on content. There's no revenue stream from it. We're all doing this stuff. You know, it's just... So I don't want to go too much into that, but it's important. So thank you.
Absolutely. Yeah. Thank you, Ted. Right. Yeah, and just as a side note, Wynton the other day called someone to thank them for a $10 donation, made someone's day. So I don't know. Could be you.
Yeah. That's how important it is.
Yeah. All right, everyone. Thank you so much. Thank you to Ted and thank you to Seton. And we'll see you online. Please feel free to follow us on social media, Jazz Lincoln Center on Facebook, jazz.org on Instagram and Twitter. Take care, everyone.
Thanks, Chloe. Thanks, Seton. Awesome,
thank you,
as always.
Ted. And thank you, Wayne Shorter.
Thank you, Wayne.
Thank you, Wayne Shorter. Thank you. All right, bye,
everyone.
Bye.